Let me first do a short introduction about myself. I'm actually normally not very good to talk about myself. I rather chat and gossip about others. But my name, as you can see over there, it's easy to remember, I guess. It's Mike, and I'm from the Netherlands. And my career is actually straight plain forward. I'm basically my whole career doing business in the pump business, pumps and systems. So. I really find it a pleasure to have this audience today in front of me with really valuable consultants and customers of Xylem. And most likely you would wonder, what the hell is this guy going to talk about? Internet of pumps? What is that? So, who knows what is here on the board? You know what it is? Yeah, of course, not people of Xylem. Yeah? It's a self-learning thermostat. Yes? And what is so great about this? Why I open my presentation with a simple, basic thermostat? You know the gold one, the round one from, I think it was from Honeywell. 35 dollars, maybe 25, yeah. This one, $250. So why would you buy a thermostat for $250? Are you crazy? Right? Totally nuts. I think on itself, a value proposition. If you are able to make a value proposition to have a basic commodity, like a thermostat, no-brainer. To move that from a $25 commodity to a $250 intelligent unit, because this is what it is. It is a self-learning thermostat. So what would you say? Okay, so you don't have to adjust yourself anymore. But this is one of the biggest innovations when you talk about Internet of Things or Internet of Everything. And it's really a pleasure to tell you a little about Internet of Things and Internet of Everything, what is actually going on in the world right now, and what is the relationship to pumps now, and maybe what is going to come in the future. And this value proposition of $250 started by a startup company in the United States back in 2010. And they introduced this thermostat in 2011. And around 2012, they had about 120 employees. Big thing, right? Well, actually, in 2014, it was acquired by Google for the price of, anyone knows? $3.2 billion. And today, Nest Labs, owned by Google, counts more than 1,000 employees. So I will try to keep it interesting because, okay, what is so interesting about data, right? It's actually quite tough to talk for an hour about data. So I made this agenda and I will try to kind of leap you into the future on Internet of Pumps. The short introduction, what you saw is not just about making predictions, because actually the world of data and intelligence is actually already going beyond that. So it's about prescriptive maintenance. And what is this prescriptive maintenance? Well, it's actually like if you go to the doctor. Yeah, the doctor writes you a prescription to take some medicines to heal you or to prevent that you're going to be more sick. So you have to be a little bit patient with me, because at the end of the presentation, I'm going to explain you how this prescriptive maintenance actually works in the real world for pumps. So let me first take you into the first basics of Internet of Things, or Internet of Everything. If you Google Internet of Things, you are going to have millions of hits. Some people say Internet of Things, other people say Internet of Everything. But basically, the Internet of Things, or Internet of Everything, they call it the first, or the fourth industrial revolution. Of course, we know all from our school lessons, at least when we were awake in the class, yeah, that the first industrial revolution started basically with the first mechanical loom, yeah, and the second industrial revolution where the electricity actually came into the industry, things being more efficient and going into mass production. So the third one, when IT started to be involved in production or in manufacturing, actually became more efficient. So the fourth industrial revolution, that's what the Internet of Things is about the last basically stage on how to connect all those efficient systems, the data out of that, to help people or machines make better decisions. And that's the fourth industrial revolution, as they call it. And which you can see already started in the year 2000 with some first basic experiments, but now it is really going into a fast, fast leap and boom going forward. So when you talk about Internet of Things, there are four basic elements which you have to take into consideration, which is the first one, of course, people. Yeah, still, it's all about people, right? You can have the most fantastic product, you can have fantastic systems and IT, but people are still a key role and part of the whole solution around Internet of Things. Where Internet of Things will evolve even further, we can already see that the wearables, for example, yeah, where you have an iWatch, but also these days you will even find t-shirts with sensors inside, who is actually monitoring while you are running your heartbeat and actually giving you some recommendations later on when you have finished your run on how to do better going forward. A typical example of Internet of Everything. So the second stage at the process side is that the Internet of Things are going to secure or give the opportunity that you're going to have the right information delivered at the right person and at the right time. For that you need to have a proper process in place. If you don't have that process in place, basically, what will the information or the data will be used of? So that data, the third stage of the whole cycle, is of course added by analytics, delivering the final intelligence on top of what people are doing, the process being handled, and the actionable information to make the right decisions at the right time, at the right place. And of course, the fourth part of that is the actual things. The actual things will become more intelligent, who will be able to make own system kind of adaption and decisions. So if you take all those four together, that's the basic of Internet of Things or Internet of Everything. Of course, if you think about Internet of Things or Internet of Everything, people very quickly move into, okay, what kind of app on my phone? Because that's basically what you do the whole day, checking your smartphone, using apps. But actually, the apps is the value of the smartphone. It's not the smartphone itself which is really valuable. It's actually the apps on your smartphone. And actually those apps are pretty stupid because they are just using the data which is generated by others or by yourself. It just moves data into information. Still, there is the final stage required of adding the intelligence, making for you the predictions, where to go, how to do it, those kind of activities. So the app on itself, of course, will involve, you will see more, but actually the app on itself is actually not the point. It's the intelligence and the backbone who is going to deliver the intelligence. Most likely you will think, oh man, this is far away. Yeah? Intelligence, how will this impact me? I selected three basic cases on how the Internet of Things actually already today is bringing value. And what you see over here, this small device, you can buy it for around $100 and you can plug it in any car built from 1982. Every car has a so-called OBD2 connector. If you bring your car to the garage, the first thing they do, they plug in a laptop, right? So they all have the same connector. So there, that device you can plug into your OBD car connector. It has an internet connection on the mobile network. By the way, you don't need to add a SIM card because it actually all has a soft SIM on it. And it has global roaming. It has a GPS and it has some sensors inside. And actually that small unit generates the data required to deliver the intelligence going forward, telling you what is your driving behavior or when your car should go to the workshop because there is a possible failure to come. And of course the next step would be not a possible failure to come, but actually what has to be done on the car to prevent that failure to come. That's the intelligence on top of it. Yeah, so here you see a case of, what was it? Yeah, in France, where data out of cars, data out of traffic systems, data out of basically systems connected to each other, actually delivering great value for a lot of stakeholders in the whole value chain. And this is a real life case. It's not far away, it is actually already happening now. Yes, maybe it's not so visual, but it is there. Here another really simplified Internet of Things solution. A sensor into a waste bin. Okay, what will that bring us? So the guy driving every day the same cycle in the city, picking up the waste bins. Maybe the bin is full or empty, but he's driving his daily process, right? So by adding a sensor of, if I remember correctly, it was around $8 into a waste bin, actually they were able to optimize the whole process of actually waste collection. Here you can see how products move into systems and systems become systems of systems. So the city of New York started to connect systems with each other and putting sensors out there in the fields and actually providing intelligent information for the drivers on the road. Really basic tough stuff, right? You would think. But all great examples of how data becomes intelligence and actually will impact the public. So how will it bring us the value? Because I'm a businessman and most of you are as well. And of course always what we think, okay, how much will it save us or how much will it bring us new revenue, right? How much money can we make out of it? So the value drivers of Internet of Things, of course, employees, people, again, yeah, about improving labor effectiveness. That will be one of the biggest savings. And by the way, it's the T is for trillion. Yes? So the Internet of Things will kind of have a value driver for employee productivity improvement globally of, yes, $1.8 trillion annually. Of course, this is a very obvious one. Military defense, combat mission effectiveness. The money spent worldwide on military, of course, goes beyond our imagination. So imagine if you would make that even more efficient on the awareness, connected command centers, vehicles connected, and so on. It will bring a huge value driver. And of course, cost reduction, improved labor efficiency, better capital utilization, a reduced operational cost. That's a big portion of it. Then we have the citizen experience, improved environment and health, because improving health means also reduction of health cost, security, and of course increasing revenue, matching demand and supply, very basic, straightforward one. So while we are here talking about pumps, and of course what is related to Internet of Things, out of the $267 billion estimated new revenue, new business out of Internet of Things, the biggest portion is actually out of smart cities. So $100 billion to come, generated of new business, new technology, new data, new intelligence, out of smart cities.
Over which period?
This is annually. Annually global. Smart buildings, for example, definitely drive, of course, operational costs down and lower energy consumption. Those are really known value drivers. An example is, for example, also in the chain is metering, smart metering. For sure, you know, in some of your countries, big projects were launched and completely failed. Yes, because there was a lack of communication or the data didn't arrive and so on. Big changes are going to make a difference going forward. As data carried in the air, the cost reduction of that will go massively down. Like you have on your mobile phone, you have free Wi-Fi. This is all top level, of course, cash generation. But the data required actually to send out of a meter or out of a pump is actually so small. Because the intelligence, you don't want to bring it all inside of an asset, of a dump asset. Actually, the intelligence is delivered in the backbone. So you just want to extract just a little bit of data to make it intelligent. So the connectivity is, of course, a big driver of Internet of Things. And already in Europe, there are new frequencies released to have very low data packages communicated over the air. And providers start to provide this kind of free of charge. Because the value, as you see today, if you remember, a floppy disk from our generation in that time, yeah, was a couple of dollars. And what was the capacity to store something, right? And what you pay now for a gigabyte of memory, yes, and what you pay today for your mobile connection, yeah, you see those costs going down, 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 down. So if you bring that all down to just a couple of bit data communication over the air, you can imagine that actually it is already close to free of charge. So getting the connectivity of of assets. We're going to make a big change in that. I think we have to look a little bit backwards before we can make a statement on what is going to happen going forward. Yeah, if you look on the one of the first slides I showed about the stages of the Industrial Revolution, questions that you are asking right now were also asked in that time. Yes, are all the people going to lose all their jobs with all the robots and the machines coming in? Yes. And actually what happened? There was more job creation, right? So most likely this fourth Industrial Revolution, of course security, big issue, but how many people actually read today the terms and conditions by updating your app on your smartphone? No one, right? So easy, just click yes, get it done, and they are getting into your private life. The Nest thermostat is all about that. Google owns, between brackets, our life on the net. The Nest thermostat is that Google wants to own you also inside of your home. They just want to have the plug and the internet connection inside your home. Self-learning about your behavior when you get up, when you go to sleep, when you go to the bathroom. Because the Nest thermostat was just for controlling the cooling and the heating. But today they have a smoke detector, yes, and they even have a camera, all connected into one network in your home. Because if you are moving around in your house, what are you going to do? Maybe they even can provide advertisements, we would say, yes? But this goes even far beyond than just commercializing advertising. This is really about your making your propositions for your healthcare, insurance, name it. The business is beyond our imagination. Those millions with those slides with trillions of dollars over there, that's not just a wild guess. Maybe it is, but all the predictions made by large companies like Cisco, name them all, they're all getting into those kind of directions of trillions and trillions of business to come out of connectivity of Internet of Things. But what is required for that, because it's a good question, of course, okay, what is going to do? But, okay, we cannot stop, right? This is going to happen. We cannot stop. Better try to take benefit out of it. But taking benefit out of that in terms of business, you have to make this mind shift. Mind shift of business on, okay, how do you actually create the value and how do you capture that value? Does this speak for itself? Does it make sense? So, a little bit closer to our daily business, right? So, here we have, and I scaled it down, so all the pump technology generations, I basically just wiped them out and I said, okay, we have the first generation pump, right? It has a motor and a mechanical part and it is connected to each other and it moves water. Great, yes? So a lot of efficiencies, improvements, make it better, using less energy. Then actually you have a second generation. Yes, you connect the pump with a pipe, you assemble it together as a kit, and actually you put a controller on top of it, and actually you have a kind of a solution. Yes? The solution, of course, comes at the moment when you start adding some intelligence on top of it. Yeah, so that the VFD has some smart intelligence inside, so it can speed up or speed down the pump when it is required and not having a constant running out of it. Yes? Products available today. Right, Salem?
Yes.
Good. So now we should talk about not just the solution, but actually the system. Because the intelligence of the machine, of the pump solution, comes really when you actually can connect that solution into a system. So now you would say, yeah, but Mike, this is already done. Yeah, we have building management systems. Great. Yeah, you're right. We have SCADA systems. Yes, that's right. But are those systems actually intelligent?
No.
No, I don't think so. I agree. Actually, those are the most stupid systems that you can imagine. Because it just switch on and off based on pre-programmed command, right? It becomes intelligent when you would connect it actually to the Internet of Things. So now you make the connectivity to your solution of course, Xylem, yes? And you transport the data into the connectivity of Internet of Things, and then you start to connect actually maybe the facility management system to the pump data. And the facility management system, of course, has also a ERP system. So now the value chain starts to increase by getting your pump data, maybe even ordering the spare parts possible required to prevent a failure coming forward. Yes? So that is systems of systems. Yes? That's where the intelligence comes. So here you have, again, your product. Over there, you make your product smart. From your smart product, you make the connectivity already available. And actually, then you start adding value on top of that. Like Xylem is already doing actually today with the Total Care program. So Total Care of Xylem can offer you services based on the intelligence within Xylem, yes, on how to take care of your pumping applications. But of course, taking real-time data out of those equipment installs, combining that with the intelligence, will make a fantastic value proposition. Make it more efficient, more cost-effective. You have a cost reduction, and for Xylem it's a new value proposition. So two out of this are actually benefiting out of it. Then it becomes really clever when you start connecting this Total Care system of Xylem into other systems. Systems of systems. Using the intelligence out of the Total Care to prevent or to take actions and make better decisions into other areas of the process. Right? So you get the slide on your USB stick from Xylem, so you can move, you can read it, because now you get a lot of information, right? And of course you have to digest. But this, I call it a simplified matrix. It's basically what you can use for any business. I transformed it into pumps for Xylem. But the, you see, as a businessman, the business opportunity over here on the left side, yes, where the evolution of the business will go, and over here, where the product value will add. So I promised you at the end of the presentation to explain on how this prescriptive maintenance actually works. So I'm going to show you now really deep inside technology, and I think most of you are engineers over here in the room, so I guess you are going to like this one. And this is not the future, this is done today.
Emtel smart machines boost industrial productivity by shifting manufacturing facilities from reactive to proactive. We do machine learning. Our smart software learns from archived sensor and maintenance data. It uncovers tiny patterns showing normal behavior for all operating states and the precise patterns that precede failures. By superimposing known failures, we can identify precise patterns that predict a future failure long before it happens. We use an artificial intelligence agent to distinguish patterns that show if the pump is operating normally or abnormally. We superimpose a vertical red line over the sensor data to indicate where the maintenance system recorded a failure. From there, the software performs a deep analysis to find minuscule patterns in the trends that show when the deterioration begins and how it develops. In addition to learning from past failures, the software can detect future anomalies, enabling it to detect types of failure modes that have never been seen before. MTEL smart agents keep learning and updating themselves, constantly identifying new failure and operating condition patterns derived from billions of sensor data values. The smart agents not only identify the failure, they automatically send alert notifications in emails and text messages to maintenance and operations staff, as well as predictive work requests directly to the maintenance system. Contact MTEL today and make your existing machines MTEL smart machines.
This company actually it's not a futuristic company like it's going to happen or this is an idea. They already implemented more than 5,000 pump systems, preventing failures and making recommendations on actually how to act on it. For sure, most likely it will take a little bit of time that the cost will go down of this system. To give you an idea, the deployment of a system like this for an oil refinery for, let's say, about 50 pumps, the cost is around $10,000 for each pump. So it is really expensive, you would say, right? But what would be the cost, actually, of losing production time or having lower efficiency? So this is for now today, for really, really critical pumps and critical processes in high value solutions and systems. Most likely, if the technology will become, like many technologies, more available into the markets, of course the price will go down, and then maybe one day even Xylem would pop it into as a standard solution into their pumps. And you can see Xylem is actually already moving in these kind of directions. Yes, you can see with the built-in VFDs, with the controls they have. Actually, there was an acquisition a couple of weeks ago of a software analytics company. So you can see that also Xylem is looking into this direction of not just the first, second or third generation, but actually utilizing software to solve the solutions for water, right? I think the subject of Internet of Things is all about protocols. We seen this happening in the building management systems, where you had Siemens, Schneider, name them all, building empires of systems and keep them closed. Because, when I own the protocol, you need to buy the PLC for me, otherwise I will not connect, right? That is already fading away. You can see, especially Schneider. Schneider is really, really leading this roadmap for buildings going forward. That they provide the data silos to third parties, of course under special agreements, but they start to understand that the one who owns the data is actually not the winner, but the one who can collaborate with others with the data will going to be the winner. But system integration still is it's getting better, definitely. I have seen really good examples by leading companies, especially the leading companies who are opening up. And the B segment or the other players in the market, they still try to protect of what they have, but I guess it is just basically a matter of time. I have been working in this industry of pumps and data now for the last 2.5 years. And this is the best what I can give you today. Is that whatever kind of system, whatever kind of software solution, if you talk with a customer, key priority is what problem is it going to solve? If the customer doesn't have a problem, but maybe, okay, maybe he's not aware of the problem, but if the customer doesn't have a problem, you can specify or sell or make recommendations for any solution, he will basically not be interested. Right? Very easy rule. Rule number one, which I have learned, talking about technology, yeah. What problem are you going to solve? Then the second one is, okay, great, fantastic, all those startup companies. Yes? Go on Kickstarter and you will find the most amazing innovations out there. Yeah? But in the professional worlds where you guys are operating, you don't want to do business with a startup company, trust me. Not handling data of these kind of amounts, getting so deeply into confidential information about processes and so on. You need to have really professionals on board. And they are out there. You just have to know them. And I have learned by failure, I can tell you. And the last one is, the Internet of Things, there will be no single one player who is going to build the Internet of Things, because as you have seen, the Internet of Things is systems of systems. That's the Internet of Things. Yeah, so partnership is really, really key. Okay? One final question maybe, before I give my podium to someone else? Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much.